Hi, you're watching Bloomberg Quint. Now, in a seminal decision that probably for the first time in this country, the central bank, that's RBI, has referred 12 large companies in this country to bankruptcy proceedings. I call this seminal because this is, like I said, the first time that the central bank has done this. This is hopeful of being able to make a dent in the NPA problem that has been hurting the Indian economy. And thirdly, this is going to be the real test of India's fairly newly minted insolvency and bankruptcy code. Now, to talk us through what this means, how it will work, if it will work at all, and what the end result will be, I have with me leading lawyer and managing partner of Cyril Amarchand Mangaldas. That's Cyril Shroff. Thank you very much, Mr. Shroff, for joining us. Look, seminal decision, you'd agree with me on this, right? 12 companies that amount to almost 25% of India's fairly large NPA problem right now. So these are large companies. We don't have the names yet of which specific 12 companies these are. Though it's easy to guess because these are supposed to be the biggest ones. What do you make of that decision and this entire resolution structure that the government and RBI seem to have come up with?
So, I think the bankruptcy process at its heart now is up to a flying start in terms of seeing how the new bankruptcy code is going to be effective in terms of resolving these cases. It's a good thing that they are not testing it with reference to small or inconsequential cases, but have done the bold thing by putting in the apparently the biggest cases in the system, and that's probably the best way of testing it, because every possible issue that you can think of will come up, will land up one way or the other in deciding how these 12 cases get resolved. Why is this important? Because amongst the challenges that were relevant, first was whether or not to refer a particular case to the new bankruptcy process or not. And there were risks associated with that. There were risks associated with the issue of who will take that decision, vigilance issues, and many questions of that nature. After the amendment to the Banking Regulation Act recently, where RBI armed itself with the powers to direct banks to refer cases to the NCLT under the new bankruptcy process, this is the first application of that power. So I think it gets over a big, not only a big sort of legal hurdle, but also a big psychological hurdle. It takes the decision of, yes, we are now going to, we have this new technology in terms of the new bankruptcy code, and we're actually going to use it. It's not just going to lie on the shelf, and we are actually going to apply it. So it's an amazing development.
Okay. Now, I'll admit that the, you know, sort of the media statement that the RBI put out just yesterday was fairly bare in terms of details, right? Except to say that these 12 companies will be referred to IBC, which is the commonly used short form for insolvency and bankruptcy code, and you'll hear us use it a lot through the course of this conversation. So what I'm trying to understand through our conversation, sir, is through your expertise of how the IBC operates, what the next steps will be. Now, from what I understand of the framework of the law itself, the next step is that, let's say, company X has now been referred to the bankruptcy proceedings. One or all of its creditors go to the NCLT, register a case under IBC, and a resolution professional is appointed to take charge of that company through the course of this entire process, right? Have I understood that correctly? That's the very first step that happens.
I think what might happen is a small procedural step in before that, which is that the RBI will actually write to each of the banks that is involved, asking them to make the reference.
Okay, fine.
So that will be the actual legal trigger.
Okay. At the time that the resolution professional takes over this company, I believe that all cases, claims, etc., go into standstill mode till this entire IBC process.
So as to allow the process to be completed in a peaceful environment.
Correct. Now, this resolution professional, sir, again, this is an untested area. This is the first time we've come up with a resolution professional in this country. And curiously, he is going to take control of the company. Yes. So the erstwhile management or promoter of the company is going to have to step aside.
The board becomes defunct in a manner of speaking, and the power moves to the insolvency professional and eventually to the creditors committee.
Now, this insolvency professional, first, his ability to take charge of large companies, because this is untested, it's new, we are in virgin area, right? Secondly, his ability to get the board to stop running the company or the management to running the company. So you're setting up an insolvency professional against a promoter. How easy is that shift in control going to be? Your thoughts on both?
So I think there will be practical challenges along the way for sure. But the legal weaponry that is required in order to implement this is there, and it's there in a fairly robust and clear form. If there are challenges along the way, I expect that the judiciary and the state machinery will step up to support this. So if somebody is not handing over possession in a manner of speaking, or if they are resisting exercise of powers by the insolvency professional or eventually the creditors committee, I think the courts will step in and support it, or the, in the first instance, NCLT will support it. And the court has been effective for a while, and some smaller cases have been filed. And every signal that we have seen so far is that NCLT and the courts are pretty serious about this implementation. Everything, all decisions by and large, have gone in favor of the creditors. So I see a seriousness and a determination of making this come alive. The black letter law in terms of the code and the regulations is almost as good as it gets. Obviously, there are some gray areas in terms of interpretation, but that's fine. I think it is still very workable. The real law on this will develop with practical applications, case studies, and live situations as they come up. And that, I think, is the real significance of what
of
has
this,
happened.
Yes, of course. Like I said, it's the real test of our bankruptcy code, so
like
to
a
speak,
few case
right?
studies.
Yeah. So, but you know, again, I'm a little confused. We are for the first time propagating an insolvency professional or body of insolvency professionals in this country. Who are these people? You would know already because you might have already at your firm seen many of these cases go through NCLT. Are they capable of taking charge of, let's say, some of the very large steel companies that we know will be in that list of 12? Are they capable of being able to move to get the board to statutorily shut down and to get the promoter to stay hands off?
So I think there's a question of sort of physical capacity of, because these are small, even the largest of the insolvency professionals are relatively small, and then there's a question of the legal power that they have. So the managements of the companies are legally obliged to cooperate with them, and if they don't, then they face legal consequences of doing so. Let's not be too harsh on ourselves. I think this is a new regime. This is a new profession that has developed as well. Whenever a new profession or a new agency like this develops, obviously you sort of start small.
Right.
But there will be capacity building as these cases evolve, as they acquire the relevant experience in dealing with these life situations. But I don't think that will be an actual problem. I think people learn pretty fast, and institutional capacity will get built up. I don't think it would have been practical for this capacity to have been built up of a scale in advance before the cases happened. You first need the cases to happen, and the capacity follows. And nature abhors a vacuum. So I think you will see people step up.
Okay, so you're hopeful that the resolution professional or insolvency professional, as you call it, that step of the process will work smoothly.
Yes,
companies will cooperate.
I think it will.
Boards
work.
Will cooperate, and the process will work smoothly.
And even
there.
If they don't cooperate, the law will deal with it.
Okay, fine. The next step of the process, sir, is the setting up of a creditors committee.
Yes.
And from what I understand, very briefly put, the creditors committee either comes up with a resolution plan or considers resolution plans, you know, recommended by other people, decides on one final one within a period of about 150 days,
yes.
failing which the company moves to liquidation process, which means there is now a time-bound process that needs to take place.
There's
right?
an end date.
Yeah. Now, maybe that's the answer to my next question, which is that when so many banking committees and lenders committees have failed, why do you think the creditor committee will succeed? Is it only because of that 150-day deadline?
That is one of the main reasons.
Okay.
I think that couple of reasons. The most important one is this, which is that in none of the other processes there was a definitive end date.
Correct.
With a terminal consequence. That is one of the highlights of the IBC. The second, I think, is also the comprehensive nature of the powers that are available in the IPC. For instance, the balance sheet can be restructured. Now, there were challenges in sort of doing it in the other modalities. You can literally rearrange the capital stack if the proposal is good and is approved by the creditors committee. That was hard to do under the other routes, and the process was far more complicated. So the breadth and depth of the remedies available under the IBC combined with the end date idea makes this, at least at this point of the journey, more powerful.
So in this situation, given these, you know, 12 companies, even if we don't know who they are, how do you see the creditors committee working? Do you expect that this committee itself will come up with a solution? Do you expect that the committee will outsource the solution, let's say to, you know, a credit recovery or an ARC kind of firm or a consulting firm or a law firm or a merchant banker? Do you see any of the other lender committees that operate under RBI's regulations, whether it's a JLF, etc., contributing resolution plans to this committee? Any idea on what we should anticipate?
I think the creditors committee does not have the monopoly on coming up with the solution. They are, of course, the approving authority. The resolution plan and the solution can come up, could come up from the creditors committee. Obviously, they will need professional advice from any of the categories that you mentioned. In addition, there could be new classes of investors. For instance, there's a new genre of in India, I think, is quite well settled abroad, of stressed asset funds.
Right, yeah. So that's what I meant instead of ARCs.
Yeah, so I think they could come up with some idea, because they would understand the value of the asset. They would have a view on what this is worth, and they could come up with a plan and pilot it through the process. The final approval will come from the creditors committee. So I think solutions can come from multiple sources, including the creditors committee, but that's a little odd. I mean, they couldn't be approving their own plan. So whilst there would be some complexities around that, I don't think that is going to sort of come in the way. But the fact is that now all of these cases are in play for finding a solution. And if there is no solution because there is no real value left in this, there will be no solution found in the timeline, and the company will have to be liquidated.
Okay. So one more question.
At least there's finality.
Yeah. One more question, Mr. Shroff, on this creditors committee, and that is that, you know, typically this problem of non-performing assets is ballooned to the size that it has because banks have so far been hesitant to be able to take the haircuts that they need to take on many of these assets for a variety of reasons, right? Now, those banks are the same ones that will be represented in the creditors committee, but of course it will go beyond just Indian lenders. My question is, if they were so far hesitant to take the 40, 50, 80% haircut that they ought to have in the past, what is going to change that courage level for them in the creditors committee, except for the time boundness of the process?
So, I think part of what the government has been trying to do, as well as RBI has been trying to do through the setting up of these committees, is to take some of the risk, the decision-making risk out of the process. The first one is the IAC, which actually decided on the 12 cases. Then there is something called the Oversight Committee, which has had a sort of a test run in the S4A process, but is still very much on the scene for the bankruptcy process, particularly for de-risking the Indian lenders. Whilst we still don't have the contours of how the Oversight Committee will work with reference to IBC cases, clearly the RBI intends, and that's the text of the 22nd May press release, intends that they will play a role in terms of facilitating and helping guiding the Indian banks in terms of taking this decision. So in a particular case, if a 40% haircut had to be taken, there were huge challenges in doing it under any of the previous system, whether it was S4A, STR, whichever, whatever.
And there were also challenges, like you said, from the vigilance point of view. No banker wanted to be the one who was making that critical decision, right?
From a corporate finance point of view, or from just from a financing point of view, everybody knew what had to be done.
Right.
But they were not being able to take the decisions because of the adverse consequences of even a bona fide decision subsequently in hindsight being seen as a corrupt decision.
Correct, right.
So whilst we have not articulated it in those terms, the distinction has now been made that this sort of committee format with the Oversight Committee's umbrella, that we probably have de-risked and been able to protect the bankers from doing what they should have done in the first place.
But the Oversight Committee exists outside the framework of the IBC, because
Correct.
The IBC process does not allow for any interference, if I may call it so, or consultation for any with any outside committee, right? So where and how do you expect this association or juxtaposition of the Oversight Committee and its views or its sanctions or its blessings to function and help the creditor committee therefore make the tough decisions that it needs to make,
so
which
the,
it hasn't been able to
make
so far?
I think the IBC is a more universal process because it takes within its sweep not just the Indian lenders but all creditors. So, but to the extent that, and we are just now worried about the vigilance and other issues for the Indian lenders.
Correct, yes.
Because they would be the ones who would typically sort of go through the adverse process if things were seen differently. So protecting them, I think, is the priority, and in most cases they would be the significant.
But how will the Oversight Committee tell the creditors committee this is okay? Because there is no provision in the law that allows for an Oversight Committee to overrule or
I think let's test it that if there was
committee.
A vigilance problem on one of these cases and it was sort of reopened up a year or two later after it was taken, clearly one of the defenses that the concerned bankers or even the individuals would have is this was run through a proper process. The Oversight Committee, which was an independent committee of the RBI, examined it and blessed it, how can it be a corrupt decision?
So you're saying that the creditors committee will not come up with a resolution plan. An informal group of bankers will come up with
a plan. The creditors committee may come up with a plan, but at least as far as the subset of the Indian lenders are concerned, they will have this protection.
So you're saying that this, you expect that the subset of Indian lenders, also represented in the creditors committee,
correct,
will take whatever plans are on the table or the best suited plan, get some sort of informal go-ahead from the oversight committee,
yes,
before the creditors
committee.
It could
be even a formal go-ahead.
Because the law doesn't provide for all these extraneous, advisory functions or anything like that.
But it's a question really of their bona fides and how they will defend themselves if there was a problem later. Now, I'm guessing over here, but I feel that the group of Indian lenders as a subset and as a sort of their universe will work in parallel with and in conjunction with the broader creditors committee under the IBC.
Okay.
They will have a lot of power because most of the value in terms of the debt is probably with them. And they could make or break any proposal.
Right.
So whilst they will be represented in a more universal format in the creditors committee, there will be a subset and probably separate deliberations which the Indian lenders will have in their group, whether it's in the JLF format or in some other format. And that group will have the protection of the creditors of the oversight committee.
Okay, fine. So that's step two.
We are guessing a bit. And we are reading between the lines.
Well, we're guessing for a lot of things, Mr. Shroff.
But we are drawing inspiration from two things, of how we saw oversight committee work for S4A, and the fact that in this RBI notification of May 4 for the bankruptcy code, there is a specific reference made to the oversight committee and actually expanding it for this purpose. So it is with some intent that it has to play
and
a role.
And this is how you read it will
this
play
is how
a
I
role.
Read it. We don't have the details, but I am reasonably confident that this would be the role that they would play.
Okay, fine. So we are assuming here that a creditors committee approves of a resolution plan, which may involve or not involve a large haircut, which has the blessings of an oversight committee,
yes,
and therefore everybody's in the safe zone, so to
yes
speak,
yes,
and the resolution plan is to be implemented. That's,
It looks like that.
Scenario
now,
one.
There might be some little bit of what comes first,
yeah,
whether the oversight committee first or the creditors. There will be some of that which will play out,
correct,
in reality. But when you reach the finishing line, the Indian lenders would have approved, the creditors committee would have approved, and the Indian lenders would have got the blessings of the oversight.
And all of that has to happen in 150 days. Because if that doesn't happen and the creditors committee does not approve a resolution plan within the time period, the entire asset or the company falls into liquidation proceedings,
yes,
correct?
Correct.
Now, in scenario one, where this does happen, and that's the good news, a resolution plan has to then be given effect to, right? Is there a timeline for that as well? Or could that drag on for a really, really long time?
I think it would depend on the content of the plan, because I mean, finally it's about making this asset useful again and resolving it. So it would depend whether it's going to be a change in the capital stack, how the haircuts would be implemented.
But in the law, is there a timeline for the resolution
there
plan?
There is a timeline in the regulation for the winding up, which is 2 years.
Okay, so there seems to be no, at least I don't remember, a prescribed
there's a
timeline two-year
line. It's
for
not
the
in
resolution.
The code, but it is in the regulations that once it goes into the winding up mode, then there is a 2-year time.
No, in the resolution mode is what I'm saying.
It will depend on the content of the plan, but it will be effective immediately. So if once the credit...
I know, but they could take forever. Suppose the resolution plan is that all banks take a haircut of 40%, XYZ assets are sold.
But that's immediately effective.
Yeah, but what if the assets don't get sold over a period of time? Right?
That will be part of the plan, right? Wouldn't it be? That they would, you'd probably
sorry,
have
again,
found...
I'm not questioning the process. I'm just trying to understand it, because like we said, this is fairly untested for all of us, and we'll be
so
watching this happen
will,
to large
it will
companies.
Typically involve, I mean, I would expect that the plan will then have a buyer on the table who will take over. There will be facilities in terms of how they will be paid.
You're expecting
the
wheels will
all
be set into motion immediately.
Yeah, and there could be solutions where what they call pre-packs could be brought to the...
So
you actually arrive at a solution, you actually negotiate it with the and then you just get it blessed by
sort
of pre-packed and then put through the process.
Fine. Scenario B in this is that the creditors committee, for whatever reasons, is not able to approve of a resolution plan within the 150 days deadline, and it moves into then what is called liquidation proceedings. Now again, I'm not sure if there is a time limit to that liquidation proceeding, but can you explain to us what happens if, let's say, a large steel company goes into liquidation proceedings? Is it sold asset piece by piece? What happens?
So there's a 2-year timeline, and it's not in the code, but it's
in the
liquidation regulation.
Like you said. Okay,
so that's the outer limit.
Okay.
And if you don't comply with that, then there's a report to be filed, which is basically to explain why not. The basic difference in a liquidation proceeding and a sale in the course of a resolution would be that at that stage you're not really selling the undertaking as a running or a going concern. You're selling the assets piece by piece.
Hmm.
The land would be sold separately. The building would land and building would be sold probably as real estate. The machinery would be sold separately. So in that you really get much less value from experience.
Right.
Now it doesn't rule out the fact that even in liquidation it can still get sold as a going concern. At least in traditional winding up that format has been used, but that is much rarer. When you actually go in for a liquidation, it's really you're just dismantling the company.
Okay. And this liquidation process, you expect that within two years, buyers will be found, etc., etc. And what is
even
the
2 years is a challenge.
What is the level of the cooperation of the promoters in and the board in all of this? Because so the resolution professional is still in charge, right? Even for the liquidation or a liquidation professional.
Yeah, liquidation professional.
Yeah, sorry, takes charge then. So.
Which in the traditional format has been the official liquidator, but that has taken
that
forever.
It's taken
over 10 years for many liquidators.
That's under SICA, that's what you're referring
to. SICA or under the Companies Act.
Companies Act.
And liquidation under the Companies Act.
So that takes forever, like you said.
It has taken forever in the past, but we've never had to deal with a law which said that there is a 2-year timeline on liquidation. What is the actual practical meaning of this timeline in this kind of liquidation, one doesn't know, but it's a good goal to have.
You see that courts might be look a little more kindly towards this if promoters and boards go running to high courts and say, hey, look, we can't do this in 2 years, it'll take 5 years, or find ways to defer this.
I think there'll be two types of promoters. One who would actually see that this is a good exit. I mean, they're getting effectively rid of a problem in terms of getting a resolution and just winding up and getting on with the rest of their life. And I think those guys will cooperate in making this happen quickly. The other type of promoter, I think, will not be able to drop their emotional attachment to the company. They will still continue to believe in the past that the equity and the board really has the control and the creditors don't. And they will resist, they will fight, and they will try to take it through the system. My expectation is that they will lose, at least if going by the current mood in the judiciary. So they might drag the time a bit, but I think it's a losing game. And consequently, they will have to be sort of forced to cooperate. And I don't think their voice is going to be remaining relevant very long, given the direction that this law has taken.
Okay. So we are testing through this process and through 12 very large companies, the abilities of resolution or insolvency professionals, liquidation professionals, what the RBI set up advisory committees, OCs, oversight committees will do. Do you believe that the infrastructure will stand up to this test? And that leads to my, sort of final question, which is that is the National Company Law Tribunal, where all of this will take place, equipped to do so, because it's almost as new as the IBC itself?
I mean, that's a very fair question. And I think the infrastructure and the sort of judicial capacity is going to be tested to the limits. But it's only when you test a system to its limits that it expands as well. So I think it will expand to fill the space. But it's not going to be an easy ride for sure.
Okay. Couple of sub-questions to that. How long do you think all of this is going to take, assuming that a resolution plan is not found? Do you think that we will see the problems of these 12 companies resolved over the next 2-year period? Because, two and a half year period, because 2 years is how long they have to even liquidate, right? Because I think the central objective of all of this is to declog the banking system, right? And if we're not able to close this within a finite period of time, in a reasonably finite period of time, what is the purpose?
So I don't want to guess the amount of time it will take, but I think it's going to be much faster than we've seen in the past. There'll be again two types of cases. One, I think in assets where there's still some value left and where you would be able to find buyers who see some value on conditions, those will get resolved fast. The latter are concerned are going to go through where there is no value left and it's just a hopeless case, where the level of the haircut is too huge or that the asset is just depreciated and there's only real estate value left, those kind of cases. Those, I think, will take much longer, and I think there's going to be very little realization from them. Now, that being said, at least those cases, you will draw a line in the sand and say, okay, wind up and let's close this chapter. So from a provisioning, accounting, and from a just bringing a legal closure to many of these, you will at least achieve that and thereby achieve the banking system being able to draw a line.
Okay. Legal challenges to this entire process. Let me break it up into three buckets. Firstly, 12 companies have been referred to the bankruptcy proceedings. Now, some of them we know for a fact are steel companies. Steel went through a fairly difficult economic period over the last 2-3 years, but things are on the upswing. You see the chance of a steel company promoter going to the High Court and saying, hey, look, I know RBI has referred my company because it's an NPA to the bankruptcy proceedings, but I think my sector's on an upswing, and I think if you give me 6 months or one year more, I'll be able to start paying back my debts and I will no longer be an NPA. Or contest this reference by the RBI to the IBC in a high court on other grounds maybe?
I think all of the above is possible, because it doesn't take very much to bring any of these challenges to the court. But if we are reading the tea leaves on how the courts have been viewing this, they have not been entertained. I mean, there are already quite a few cases that have been decided.
At the NCLT regarding the
and
IBC.
And also some of them have gone to the High Court and to the Supreme Court. So the judicial posture seems to be, this is a legislation meant for a specific purpose. It serves a wider public interest. We are going to be hands off unless there's something blatantly wrong in the process. Now, amongst the challenges that could be launched over here is they were not heard, natural justice, etc. But even there we are seeing a trend in terms of the courts staying hands off on this. But whether promoters or founders and boards who still want to cling on to their assets will challenge this or not, I think they will, but we just have to go through that.
I suppose you are going to repeat your answer for my second question, which is the second potential set of challenges. One is at the stage of reference to the IBC.
Yes.
The second is at the stage of the resolution plan being finalized, right? A promoter doesn't like the resolution plan. It doesn't fit into what his scheme of things is for that company. Do you see, you know, again, a whole set of challenges there? And sorry if I'm asking you to repeat yourself in short again.
But the answer may be a little different, because I would assume that the debtor would be heard.
Okay.
Because the process, I think the law envisages that whether he doesn't have a vote or doesn't have an ability to influence the outcome, but he certainly has a right to be heard.
So he'll be heard by the creditors committee.
He'll be heard by the creditors committee. Correct. And his viewpoints, if valid, would be taken into account.
Yeah, but suppose he doesn't feel like he's gotten justice there. Do you see him approaching the higher courts saying, look, I don't agree with this resolution plan. They did not accept my resolution plan. And this resolution plan is against
I think that can happen, because that's a natural emotional reaction of somebody who's dissatisfied. But crystal ball gazing into the outcome of some of those, I think he will say that, but not with much success.
Okay. And the final question in terms of, legal challenges, the first thing that we spoke about, this entire system or solution has been designed to take some of the blame off banks, right? The finger pointing that banks were scared of.
Yeah.
Do you think this is going to achieve that?
I think this has got as good a chance as any. There was another idea that was mooted some time back, which was an amendment to the Prevention of Corruption Act, which was statutory, seeking to draw a definitional difference between a bona fide bad decision and a corrupt decision. I don't think that actually sort of went through.
No, the IDBI bank situation has spooked several bankers. Right?
Exactly, and I think that is the showcase situation which is in the psyche of the banker. So that was probably one route, but I think that had its challenge. What the RBI has now done, I think, is the second best solution to that, which is committeeize the whole decision-making process and create an institutional mechanism by which there is firstly less scope for any wrongful or corrupt decisions taking place, and also providing some kind of a statutory cover for this. So my guess is it serves the purpose. A lot will depend also on how the investigative agencies look at it. I mean, finally, it will be the likes of the vigilance authorities or CBI and others, how they will see this. But now that this is more well set, I doubt whether we are going to
see. And it's a national problem. Now it's no longer the problem of one bank, two banks or three promoters, right,
correct,
at the end
of
the day. So, Mr. Shroff, final question then to wrap this up. I'm not trying to knock what the efforts have been made by RBI and the government in this process, but realistically, do you believe this is going to lead either to recovery of some of those assets or at least to unclogging, unjamming the banking system?
I think the answer is yes. Not as much, I think, as the system expects.
Okay.
But I think we're going to see progress.
And in the next 2 years, we will see...
I don't think we're going to solve the whole problem by this, but even if we solve 50% of the problem, that's massive.
In the next 2 years, I'm only talking 12 companies right now, 25% of the NPA problem. The remaining 75%, we haven't even gotten into this conversation because we still need to know the modalities of how that will be dealt with, right?
I think from all the times that you have known me, you've always known me to be an optimist. So I will continue to end on that optimistic note, that this is this has got as good a chance as any, but we should not underestimate the challenges. And I think there will be a lot of learning involved in this process as well.
All right, Mr. Shroff, thank you very much for speaking to us here at Bloomberg Quint. And thank you very much for watching.